My name is Rebecca Dutta, and we are at the De La Zerda Lab at Stanford University under the Structural Biology Department, and I am a research assistant here. So I just grew up across the bay here in Fremont, so I'm from around here. So I've always really loved to read. I read sort of voraciously as a kid, to the extent that I would hide books in my bathroom to read them while I was in the bathroom. And apart from that, I loved hiking, and I still do. You have this huge push to just learn everything, but you know, knowing that you will never know everything, and I think that's what motivates me the most, just knowing that I won't always know the answers to everything. I work with our imaging technique, which is OCT. My own project that I'm starting off right now is looking at circulating tumor cells. We're trying to look at a tumor that's growing inside the body, and you can't really see it unless you literally excise it out. Well, we use this technology because we can use it in a living, breathing patient without having to do any kind of surgical intervention. You can still see the tumor, for example.
So I'm using polystyrene beads as a mock-up for a circulating tumor cell, and to that I'll conjugate a golden aneurone, and then I'll image it using our Telesto, which is our imaging system. So these little things that you see that are blinking, those are actually polystyrene beads, and you can take several different scans.
I mean, theoretically, you can think that if we have something that can target a tumor cell very specifically, you can even conjugate a drug molecule to it and have it specifically target a tumor cell and destroy that tumor cell without destroying anything else in the body. So, I mean, that's very far down the line, but I mean, you can imagine that using this kind of technology and this kind of like specificity, you could get to that point. You know, once you start working in a lab, it's just so much fun to be able to learn new things from different kinds of people and see things through different lenses. And that's always been a fascinating experience for me and really one of my motivators for going into science. Feeling like you know exactly what you want to do is probably not a good thing. Just explore different avenues. Computational is a huge part of the sciences, and that was always a sort of scary aspect for me because I felt like I was fine at math, but it wasn't my favorite subject or anything. But getting over that was really fun, actually. I went to college down south in Southern California at a liberal arts college for women called Scripps College. I took classes that were co-ed, but it was really interesting, just the amount of passion and enthusiasm there was for science, especially among the female members in my class. It was very empowering for me. You never felt like you were behind any other gender or anything like that. You always felt at the forefront.
I've been paying more attention into this area, this subcortical area, that often gets a little bit ignored.
I think there is a misconception that fields in STEM that are more mathematically based are no place for a woman to be in, and I think that is a huge misconception. I see it amongst my female friends. I think that's the reason why there are more females in more biology-related fields in STEM rather than more engineering or computer science-based fields. And that's a little sad to me. I think a lot of the problem-solving happens at the intersection of those two different fields.
Yeah, I don't know what happened, if it just got scratched or...
I'm not sure either, actually,
it's in everyone.
This was a percentage of women in the professional fields of physics, math fields, and medical science fields, and computer science is the red line.
I would really encourage, you know, any girl out there who's thinking about it and maybe is a little bit terrified of, you know, what a computational future might look like, to really pursue it. In general, when I, you know, just open the news or hear about someone that's been suffering from, like, let's say cancer, it is a motivator, and I don't even need someone close in my life. It's just, it's all over the place. It's so prevalent that, you know, it's forever a scary thing. And what keeps me in research all the time is the opportunity to make a difference from a very basic level, from a like technique level, from a pharmacological level, that I think is just as important as, you know, being in contact with a patient. And so that's really what keeps me in science and what keeps me excited about, you know, what I do every single day.